Good morning to all the viewers. We are starting the 12th day lecture. Baliram, Vamsi, Annapragada, Anuke Rao. Good morning to all of you. Ravi Bhaskar, Nagasai, Hemant Reddy ji, Krutad Patak, Selvaraj Gopal. Hi Subhash ji, good morning. Maverick, KGK garu, good morning, namaste. Ravindra Kole, Ajit Kumar, Ravi Kumar, Arbaz Parvez, Abhinav. Good morning, KGK garu. Kiran Belavi. Hi, Sridhar Babu. Ganesh Nimje. Good morning, Valavo Karvalo. Inam. Hari Prasad. Sayad Ikram. Yeah, punctuality also we have to learn. It's also part of training. Ramakrishna Raki. Subhash ji, I can't understand Tamil. I can't read Tamil. I can understand Tamil. Rohit Potu. Kiran Deshmukh. Dilip Yadav. Ashok Kumar. Hi Jagdish. Varshit. Hi Durga Prasad Deepi. Good morning to you. Good morning to all my friends. Venkat Rao. Giri Yadav, Srikant Rao, Balmuri, Vijay Singh, Rajput, Hi Abdul Kalam, Rohit, Hi Pradeep Dharam, thank you for all your support. Please correct me if I am talking anything wrong today. You are having a lot of practical experience, Pradeep, KGK Garu, Vishwanathan Gupta, Akash Karnam. We'll be starting in 2 minutes. Swapnil, Krishna, Sakari, Sudhir Gangal, Akondi, Chakravarti. Hi Srivasav, Maul Rao, Abhinav. Good morning to all of you. Satish Bhatt. Hi Dheeraj, good morning. Hi Anant. Akondi Chakravarti. Salman Ahmad. Very happy to see every day. Good morning. Yogesh Lambate. Prafulla, Nishant Agrawal. So another 1 minute. Madhukar Kadam, Amit Rangire, Madhu Reddy, Subramanyam, Manish Tomar, Chandru Kannan. Irfan. Satyasri. Yeah, I'm fine, Satyasri. How about you? Yash Kinwasara, Jakir Hussain, Malayadri, Ranga Satam, Mohammed Manzoor. Yes, it's time. We'll start our topic today. Ground improvement, soil stabilization, PVDs, stone columns, slope stabilities, black cotton soils and soil nailing. The topic is big, but I think I'll be able to cover comfortably. So the contents or overview of the topic is introduction. Basically, we all know one way is to live with the soil, whatever soil we have. Another thing is to improve the characteristics of the soil. That is called ground improvement. Every time we don't resort to this ground improvement, but when it is necessary, as I mentioned in the previous lectures, even if you cannot walk into the site, then we have to do ground improvement. We cannot do backfilling, we have to do ground improvement. We cannot do excavation, then it requires ground improvement. So there are many occasions where we have to resort to ground improvement, which has many types actually of ground improvement, which I'll be covering today. The types of ground improvements that are possible and what are the problems during ground improvement. And illustration, I'll share some of the experiences that we have and project case studies. Today I'll be sharing not only my projects, I'll be sharing projects of my consultant, Rambabu, engineer Rambabu. I have shared some of the projects he has executed also to explain, because it is for education. I requested him and he readily accepted. I thank Rambabu for giving me that opportunity, because it's a huge subject and soil keeps varying and strata keeps changing. And so we'll cover in depth about that. And mainly as engineers, consultants, people at the site, we have to definitely debate, brainstorm on the method of this soil stabilization or slope stabilization. This is the topic of today, I'll be covering today. So what is ground improvement? The definition is the process in which in situ soils are improved for the support of the foundation is known as ground improvement. That means we don't take the ground as it comes. We will ask for improvement, we'll do the improvement. And the changes made through these three process are permanent and are not affected with the passage of time. That means whatever ground improvement procedure we adopt, it should be also having durability along with the structure, because we are whatever structure or pavement we are going to do on the ground, it has to live with the structure. Otherwise the improvement that we adopt, if it is decays or degrades, then the very purpose will be defeated. If you are designing the structure for 100 years, ground improvement also should be there for 100 years. The main objective of this process is to increase the density and shear strength parameters basically. This is when we have very weak shear parameters, particularly the soils like clay soils, loose clay soils, silty clay soils or marine clays are the types where it is very essential to go for this ground improvement. And compressibility to be decreased. This is another permeability also is another problem we have, like in case of reservoirs and all that, water storage reservoirs or dam sites and all. Settlement to be contained. When we have excessive settlements in the soils, we get SPT sometimes 1-2 kind of values. So, and it's not that if there is no farm strata available beyond within 2 meters, 3 meters or up to 10 meters also, we cannot have foundation beyond 10 meters, and every structure we cannot keep going for deep foundation. And sometimes you even up to 40 meters you don't get hard strata. There are many cases. So in such cases it is good to resort to ground improvement for better shear parameters, better increased compressibility, decrease the compressibility, reduce the permeability and reduce the settlement. So this is the main purpose of So this picture talks about it all. You can see, even for driving the pile, the rig cannot reach the site. So we are using the sleepers for moving the rig even to the site. So this is an example, and on the side you can see the shoring, the sheet pile. There is a water body immediate next to the site. So this is the case where you have to improve the ground compulsorily, because you can't start your work. So this is an example of ground improvement. And ground improvement will be done on the surface sometimes, up to 1 meter depth sometimes, and up to deep depth even. So I'll be going in detail about this. So why are these techniques required, and what are those techniques? That's what we are going to discuss today. The objective of soil stabilization is to improve on-site materials to create solid and strong subbase. This is what I am telling, up to 1 meter, 2 meters, when we have these runways or pavements, we go for shallow depth stabilization, soil stabilization that is called. This is also part of ground improvement. And long-term performance of pavement structures often depends on the stability of the underlying. That means when you have low CBR values for laying these pavements, we'll go for stabilization. And engineering design of these constructed facilities relies on the assumption that each layer in the pavement has the minimum specified structural quality to support the and distribute the superimposed load. So this is the main objective of this ground improvement. And the process is to increase the density, shear parameters, and decrease the compressibility. Now, what are all the techniques that we have for this ground improvement? So the types of ground improvements are cement or lime stabilization. We use cement or lime stabilization. Geosynthetics. This I worked with my friend who is a professor in IIT Bombay now. He's a pioneer in his reinforced earth and geosynthetics. He did his doctorate and is an expert. I keep taking his advice, Professor BVS Vishwanath in IIT Bombay. In fact, I was doing structural engineering and he was doing geotechnical, and I used to help him finite element modeling of this reinforced earth with the geotextiles. So this is about 32 years back. So geosynthetics has started 35 years back itself, the research and development. And now it is in the field. Lot of materials, products are available, and we are implementing this reinforced earth using geosynthetics. And next is the stone columns. So this also is another method, old method, but now we have mechanization available even for stone column. Another is reinforced earth. This is being widely used in retaining walls and bridge approaches. Actually, most of the bridge approaches we see precast retaining with reinforced earth. So they are called reinforced earth retaining wall, or embankments, where reservoir embankments and all, we are doing this reinforced earth where to improve the shear capacity of the slopes. Actually, next is the PVDs, porous vertical drains or prefabricated vertical drains. And jet grouting is another method of ground improvement. Chemical and permeation grouting, this is a method. This is again grouting. Compaction grouting is a method. Soil compaction will be done by grouting. Actually, see, basically we have to stabilize the soil. When the soils are loose, we can stabilize these soils either by chemical or by compaction or by adding stone column kind of things or reinforcing it. So these are all the different methods we are doing. So compaction grouting is one method. Soil mixing, this is another thing. You mix the soil with a good substance that will give the better parameters for the soil. Deep densification, this is another method. And for embankments, we use geomembrane, geotextile or geoweb, the slope protection and all that. So these are all the types of ground improvement techniques in different classification. So we have traditional stabilizers generally rely on pozzolanic reactions and cation exchange to modify and stabilize. Among all traditional stabilizers, lime probably is the most routinely used. I'll cover all the aspects. I'll answer the questions after I complete my talk. So you can keep asking, no problem. Modern practice of stabilization is limited to traditional chemical stabilizers like Portland cement or PPC even, and lime and fly ash. However, it is important when considering treatment with these traditional products to broach the subject of non-traditional or alternative stabilizer. So we have to, now we have products, actually there are companies which are supplying these stabilizing compounds also. I came across some UP based company also. So this is a cement lime stabilization, you can see. There are all equipment available. We will put the slurry of the cement, then we have a machine that mixes the soil with this cement, lime or pozzolanic material. So this is cement lime stabilization. And normally this stabilization is adopted for large areas, this method. And so cement lime stabilization for pavements, roads and then runways also. In fact, we adopted for runways this cement lime stabilization, which I'll share. And geosynthetics and soil reinforcement. This is another physical reinforcement of the soil actually. We reinforce the soil with the synthetics. Because the shear, I think you must be aware, you must have adopted a conventional method of improving ground is to fill in layers. We specify in backfilling many times that one layer of clay and one layer of sand or murram, that kind of. So when you have layers of this soil, that will improve the shear capacity of the soil. It's not surface, it is actually 1 meter depth. It shows like that, but there will be a machine that mixes the soil and this cement slurry or lime slurry or ash, fly ash slurry to make it this one. Picture looks like it is surface spray. And this includes 8 main product categories, geosynthetic products. They are polymeric products, and to solve civil engineering problem, we have geotextiles, we have geogrids, we have geonets, we have geomembranes, we have geosynthetic clay liners, we have geofoam, we have geocells, and we have geocomposites, geocell or geoweb. So the polymeric nature of the product makes them suitable for use in ground where high levels of durability are required. That means we know that the polymer has got very long life. Provision of drains in soil which is loaded may be lead to settlement while gets drained. Yeah. So they can also be used in exposed applications like LDP, HDP sheet I have used in reservoirs. When it is exposed, we have to go for HDP, or when it's not exposed, when it is buried, we can go for LDP sheet also. That forms the impervious layer. Olden days, we used to use clay blankets for preventing permeability. Red soil is also clay soil actually, yeah. So these are the geotextiles. I'm showing you the pictures of samples that we get. There are a lot of companies nowadays supplying these geotextiles, geogrids. Geogrid is nothing but like our reinforcement, tensile reinforcement, two directions, one direction, one-way geogrid, two-way geogrid, and all that. And we have these geomembranes. Geomembranes we use when we need permeability to be controlled also. That is we have used in one of the project runway where there is a water table coming up. So to protect our layers, subgrade layers, we have used this geomembrane. And geosynthetic clay liners, that also we use for clay soils. And geocells, you can see this, they are like cells. They are spread like a web, you know, cobweb, and then filled with soil. So you will have confined soil cells actually. And next we have these geocomposites, that is not purely synthetic, but it's a composite material. And we have geo nets, net can be spread like. I will cover black cotton also in the next coming slides. This is geofoam, it's a basically lightweight material, and where we have to go for filling and all that, we use this. So geosynthetics or soil reinforcement, we get like this and we'll spread and apply. Stone columns. These are vibro stone columns actually, designed to improve the load bearing capacity of in-situ soils and fills. Here I am not giving the design aspects, I am not a geotechnical man. So you must approach the experts for design. But I am only sharing the methods that we have adopted and in situ soils and fills, and to reduce the differential settlements of non-homogeneous and compressible soils, allowing the use of shallow footings and thinner base slabs. So this is basically for improving the shallow depth things. And stone columns are formed by inserting vibrating probe to incorporate granular aggregate into the ground via the resulting, so that means you insert the rig, vibrate it so that the soil stabilizes, and the void formed will fill it with the granular aggregate. So that will provide the drainage as well as it. We have compacted the soil, and it will also act as a pile. The granular aggregate in a augered bore will act as a pile, and when we put the footing on top of these stabilized soils, it will have a better bearing capacity because we have improved the shear capacity by consolidating the soil, and also providing pile kind of thing for transferring the load to the better strata at deeper depths. The stone columns are typically installed under uniformly loaded structures such as building slabs and embankments. Even embankments, it is very advantageous because of its drainage capability. So this is a method of inserting the stone column. Here you can see we are inserting the rig and we are vibrating. When we vibrate, it will consolidate the soil around. So the spacing of this stone columns and the diameter of the stone column is all designed by considering the soil strata, its characteristics, and spacing of this also is decided. And once we reach certain level up to here, we'll start filling with aggregate. Again, we'll vibrate this aggregate so that aggregate will not be loose and it is compacted, and we reach to the top and move to the next thing. So this is the method of stone columns. And this is another type of stone column. On the real site, you can see there will be a rig and we drill the holes and will provide this kind of aggregates inside the voided bores actually. Next is the porous vertical drains. This is mostly advantageous where we have the water table. When we have a water table, you cannot consolidate easily. With vibration, it will not be effective. So what we do is, we provide a porous vertical drain where the water comes out through this vertical drain. When you take out the water, then the in marine clays that gets stabilized. Low permeability soils where that means soil, if it is having low permeability, then these vertical drains will help in taking out the water, and so the settlements can be prevented after filling actually. So we'll be filling. So prefabricated vertical drains consist of flexible plastic core in cylinder shape, wrapped in a spun bond filter fabric, and there will be a filter also so that the soil won't come out. Installed in depths of more than 50 meters, these porous vertical drains. There are specialist agencies like Bharat Geo, and depending on the type of nature of the soils to be treated, it is also possible to install sand or stone drains. So, depending on the nature of the soils. So, this is the method of porous vertical drains. Even for rig to go, we have to start from the edge of the property where we will start improving and the rig starts moving. And then we will install this this mantle or compressible soft soil to be consolidated. And this is the drain is cut so that the water will come out. When we fill the soil, the water will be coming out of this. So we have to provide the drainage for this water after filling actually. Due to the water burden itself, the water will come out. The pressure. So this is the porous vertical drains being installed, you can see on a site. Next is the jet grouting. It's a grouting technique that creates in situ geometries of soilcrete, that means grouted soil, that means soil concrete kind. Using the grouting monitor attached to the end of the drill stem. That means we'll be seeing the soil and we jet grout to create the soil concrete. Velocity of grout jet depends on the water water or saturation level in the soil and the soil type. So this is the jet grouting actually. You can see they'll be drilling the hole and send the grout material through the jetting. This is compaction grouting. It is also known as low mobility grouting. Yeah, I'll take the questions after I finish my talk. Compaction grouting, also known as low mobility grouting, is a technique that displaces the and densifies loose granular soils. It's basically for granular soils and reinforces fine grained soils and stabilizes subsurface voids or sinkholes. So, I'll talk about liquefaction also. Yeah, by the staged injection of low slump, low mobility aggregate grout. So, compaction grouting has been used increasing bearing capacity and decrease the settlement and liquefaction potential for planned and existing structures rotated and raised. So, this is the compaction grouting. So, there is an existing structure you can see there, and we will be doing this compaction grouting to improve the shear capacity of the soil so that the settlements can be prevented in future. Soil mixing, wet soil mixing, also known as deep mixing method, is a ground improvement technique characteristic of weak soils by mechanically mixing them with cementitious binder slurry to construct columns. A powerful drill advances drill steel with radial mixing paddles. That means like augers, they will be mixing the soil by pumping the cement slurry, binder slurry into the bore actually. So here you can see this is that kind of auger thing, and it will drill the hole and we send the mix slurry and then it will mix the soil and it will form the columns like this. For clay soils, yeah, particularly in clay soils, it can be advantageously used by mixing sand and fly ash. So it will form a good soil. Fly ash is a binding material, sand is a aggregate, and clay, fly ash and sand will form like micro concrete, you know, and it is adopted in the design by considering the mix of sand and fly ash as per the design. And considering, we have to also check the soil parameters of the clay soils, whether it is what is the liquid limit and the plastic limit and all. Next most important thing is slope stabilization. In deep excavation or even tunnels, we go for deep tunnels and we use the soil nails, we use the ground anchors. Ground anchors can be passive or active anchors. Today I'll be talking about active anchors, which is very advantageous technique and more reliable technique, and my experience in drafting that specification and all that, and the soil improvement for slope stability also. And we use these board piles or touch piles and micro piles also for slope stabilization. Deep mixing is nothing but we drill like 50 meters bore or 40 meters, 30 meters bore, and mix fly ash and sand and mix with the soil. That is called deep mixing method with augers. And slope stabilization in deep excavations, we also use these diaphragm walls or sheet pile and also top-down construction in deep excavation, where we have these water tables, advantageously we can go for top-down construction for saving the time. So soil anchors or ground anchors is a pre-stressed or grouted soil anchor. It's a structural element installed into the soil that is used to transmit an applied tensile load to the ground or soil. That means we compress the soil and apply the tension to the anchor and lock it. It consists of a free length and fixed length. Basically, the free length is where there is no good strata of soil. We drill a hole. I'll show the pictures. And then when we encounter the good strata, then we grout that good into the good strata, this anchor. So when you tension it, like a dead end and live end in post-tensioning actually. So we'll anchor the one end in a fixed length, and then we'll tension it and put the wedges and anchor plate. And also we'll use the shotcrete or gunneting for putting the surface dry and protecting the surface on top. So this is the concept of slope stabilization. In fact, when you take any finite element of a soil here, it will have all sides pressure actually. That means it is in equilibrium before starting the excavation. Once we start the excavation, that means on one side we are removing the soil. That means this side pressure is not there, so it becomes unstable. This is the basic concept of slip circle and soil stability because of the shear imbalance. So typical construction sequence for this is we drill a hole, and this is the fixed zone and this is the free zone. So we put a rod after drilling the hole, and we grout in this dark area. This is the rod we are inserting. So we have inserted the rod in the photograph, you can see. And we do the shotcrete after inserting the rod. Here you can see shotcrete is done. And then we put the pad or beam here after putting the anchor. And then valors, we put the valors. And then stress the anchor. That means we are applying the compression to the soil, and then lock it. This is by using the wedge we are locking. So this is the method of execution. Please use the experts for execution as well as design. I am only giving the method for us to understand. I am trying to explain how I feel this is more reliable than normal nailing or touch piles or piles. In what type of soils we can go for touch piles and what type of soil we can go for anchor. This I am going to discuss and explain today. So here when we apply this compression, this is the zone of influence of the soil. So we are inducing the compression in the soil. So like that, when we have a series of anchors like this, that means we are creating a shear resistance for this soil. And we are thereby, if you see the slip circle also, you have the anchor reinforcement of rods, and they are anchored, and also we are inducing the shear stress in the soil compression by compression, so that it will resist the any failure. So this is the stressed zone, you can see. So it is that itself will, soil itself will act as a retaining wall. But why this is more reliable is because depending on the varying strata, you know, the soil, this I am talking about 20 meters depth, 10 meters depth kind of depths where we need to excavate, where if we are stressing the anchor, we know the effectiveness of this and how much tension we can give. Whether, so that means indirectly we are testing the entire strata of the soil with this stressing actually. So that's very important, whereas in touch piles or board cast in situ piles, I'll explain how difficult it is to understand the strata and how they can fail. So here you can see we are inducing the compression to the soil. Advantage is every soil anchor is stressed and tested. Soil reinforcement at the face due to induced compressive force, and suitable for design as you build approach. That means we are testing every 1 meter by 1 meter soil with this stressing actually. Very flexible, follows excavated contours. We can do as we have excavated. There is no fixed line, verticality and all that required. I'll show the pictures, and it is cost effective. I don't say cheap, but it is a cost effective and fast for execution. And disadvantage is it's not an universal solution. It cannot be a generic solution. I come across some people doing it as a norm, but it's not good. You have to go for the design, you have to consider the shape, because lot of analysis, Plexus is a software used for, because you have to consider the saturation levels and the water table level and the soil type, soil strata, everything. We have to rely on the expert geotechnical consultants and execution agencies for this. Yeah, that's why I said water, we have to consider. So problems during slope stabilization is liquefaction, quicksand condition also can happen, and settlements. So soil liquefaction describes the phenomena. This is, many people were asking me before also, how do you tackle the soil liquefaction? So in this presentation, I have the solution. I'm offering a solution, one solution for liquefaction. Normally liquefaction occurs during earthquake shaking or any change in stress condition, sudden change in the stress condition. Liquefaction is nothing but the soil acting like a liquid. I'll show you some of the photos. So this is the, you can see some buildings collapse because of the liquefaction like this, and these pavements and drains, you can see the liquefaction. Quicksand condition we see in dams and earthquakes where the high water pressure increases, the earth pressure will be more than earth pressure, and then soil acts as a water or liquid. So this is the quicksand condition. So that means settlement, if you conduct SPT is negative, like even if without any applying force, it will settle. So consolidation is a process by which soil decreases in volume. And Terjaghi, we all know, says consolidation is any process which involves a decrease in water content of saturated soil without replacement of water by air. That means the voids are filled by the soil itself when you have the water. And it occurs when stress is applied to the soil that causes soil particles to pack together more tightly, therefore reducing its bulk volume. So this is the definition. When stress is removed from the consolidated soil, the soil will rebound, regaining some of the volume, consolidation process. So this is the soil settlements we see, and illustration. Now I'll be sharing the examples of soil stabilization with the cement lime for runways we have done. And we have used Tencat company geomembrane for handling water table and liquefaction of the runway, where we had these silty clays in the strata. And the stone columns that we have used for the foundations, PVDs we have used in a Cochin project, and deep excavation. Shoring piles versus active anchors. This I'll be sharing photographs and all what, and I'll explain. Black cut and clay soils, external cut off trench and drain. That means we can handle the expansive nature of the soil by giving provision for expansion. Don't restrict it, then it will expand laterally. Then it's no problem. So we have to understand the soil parameters, as I always mention, with backhoe pits and soil investigation. So this is the runway where we have done the soil stabilization before doing all this upgrade preparation. And these are polypropylene things used on the ground for using it as a runway or road, you know, temporary. That means when the soil is bad, when you don't have time to prepare the roads and all, we use these polypropylene geogrids. And this is the soil where this is a filled up soil before PVDs are done. And we did the PVDs in Cochin and then filled up the soil. Here you can see the nail drilling with a crane holding the rig actually. This is a very good, this is not my project photograph, but it's very interesting. You have this kind of technologies available. Already excavated, and these are the piles, and you can drill the holes or shoulders, sorry. These are the shoulders. And then you can drill the anchors and support, and then simultaneously do the retaining wall construction. So this is a project which we did in Bangalore. This is the existing campus, and these are the two buildings we had to construct. You can imagine this is a five-storied building adjacent to which we had to excavate 20 meters. So this is the excavation. So before we started this excavation, the piles are done. These shoring piles or touch piles are done. So this is another site where this nails are done, soil nailing is done, and the garniting is done to protect the surface. Here also you can see soil nailing is done. And this is a excavation before exposing the piles. And here you can see these are the touch piles, and we have the capping beam. And there's a building next to it. So this is also touch piles. In fact, touch piles are terminated thinking, you know, when we do these touch piles, we do it blind actually. That means when we encounter the hard strata, they think it's a hard rock. They can't auger anymore, so they terminate. As per the design, we had this bench here and we had a slope defined here. And these touch piles are terminated at 12 meters, though the total depth of excavation required is 20 meters. So then the story has begun here. And one strata where we had uniform soil strata up to 20 meters, touch piles work perfectly. That means you have to go by the soil investigation. The soil investigation will give you to understand the strata. Suppose I have to excavate 20 meters, you should see entire soil site, how the strata is varying. So in one particular building, we had uniform soil. There is no rock. So we could do the touch piles up to below 20 meters. We have done the socketing, and you can see the valors here. Sorry. These are the three levels of valors and capping beam. It's all done before excavation, and we have completed the excavation, and we could complete the construction very without any problem. Here you can see the previous 12 meters termination, where due to time schedule, this project we had to complete in 30 months. And so you can see how many breakers are employed. This is all soft rock actually, or weathered rock. And so how many breakers are there? 8 breakers working simultaneously. Can you imagine how an engineer can control this kind of... My engineer has taken the video of this. Yeah, by tests we have to do the validation of the ground improvement. And here, when this was done, the rock strata, there was undercutting below the piles actually. And you know, when there is an undercutting below the pile, the wedges won't work. This valor and nails are staying because of the wedges. And when there is a vertical movement in the pile, these wedges will fail or get released actually. So this is the thing which we have foreseen actually. We were arguing against this piles, touch piles or shoring pile, but the contractor has taken a deviation and gone for this, and this is the result. The soil has failed, the piles have collapsed because of the undercutting below the piles. So please do understand, when we go for this kind of thing, we have taken the advice of the geotechnical expert, and for this kind of site, active anchors would have been the ideal solution, not the touch piles. So this is very important. One consultant or engineer in charge has to go by the advice of the geotechnical expert. This is such a fine line between adopting the touch pile and active anchors. We are not talking about whether to go for protection or not. Protection is there, but even when you decide the protection to be done, what type of protection is very important. So we have to, as engineers, we should go by the advice of the geotechnical experts. So this is the restoration. You can see we had to bring 20,000 sandbags in a day. Imagine the effort required to do it, to protect the building next to it. So 20,000 sandbags and polythene sheet, because it was a rainy season, and we had to do this by night. From the morning till night, we have done this. So 24 hours, it is restored. So you can see the berms and all that. And then we started implementing the nails. Here you can see the nails are done, and this backfill is removed gradually. So this is the after providing the reinforced nails, anchors. So this is the anchor, and you can see the mesh reinforcement and the shotcrete that is done. So, and this is the anchoring of that anchors. So these are some of the sites where people do without any protection itself, which is very dangerous. Please don't resort to it, and definitely take the advice of the geotechnical experts. So these are all the sites, ramps, earth ramps I talk about for excavation and all that. And this kind of sites where the soil condition is very bad, you need to do the ground improvement. So now I'll be giving the illustrations by company called Arch Utraco Ryobi Geo Engineering Private Limited. I have borrowed their I have attended a lot of presentations by Engineer Ram Babu, and he is also CEO of Bharat Geo Engineers Private Limited. And I'll be showing some of the examples, because I have not many of the photographs or methods done. Now, when you do the breaking of weathered rock, you can't really have a line of cutting. It will break as the faults are there. So though we have drawn a line, we have formed the berm line, and the socketing is done. When these so many breakers worked to cut that 8 meters, balance 8 meters, the undercutting happened by accident actually. When the undercutting happens, then the piles settle, you know. The piles have settled and wedge got released and it has collapsed. So this is the reason why I say that the engineers have to decide the most reliable and risk-free method of slope protection. So that's why we have to depend on experts, geotechnical experts. Many are there actually. Ram Babu is one whom I rely on always. And so these are all the presentation of Arj. Some of the works were done before commencing the excavation itself. Some of the works were done after failure happened. So it is better to prevent the failure and follow these methods before commencement of excavation itself. So here you can see they have started putting the nails. Every 2 meters excavation, they put the nails, protect, and then go for the next level of excavation. So these are the nails and shotcrete you can see. This is the shoring work. Next is another project. You can see the valves and wedges being provided after stressing. So this is the closer view of the shoring. You can see after tensioning, this is locked here with the wedge. And so this is a shoring works for Ganga Foundation. So this is a, you can see once we have reached the level required, we have so many valves, and as we come up with the construction, we can remove these valves. Or you can leave it also in the site. So this is the method of slope protection. You can see there are buildings next and they are protected very well. And this is another photograph of the same site. You can see the waterproofing is done before raft is laid. And a commercial project, slope stabilization. So here also you can see this is all done before only, before any failure occurred. But there are some cases where failures occurred and then the slope protection people are called and restored the slopes like this. So here you can see the compound wall on the boundary, almost excavation is done. So there is a very good software Plexus for designing this properly and executing this. So let's not break our head. Refer it to an expert. So these are all the anchors. And this is another example. These are all done before failure, as the excavation progresses. Soil nails and gunneting. And this is a temporary slope stabilization for a hospital in Hyderabad. Here, this is the new excavation. This is the existing building. And they have started excavating without slope stabilization. Here, you can see. And so soil report has to be checked, considered. This is the varying strata you can see. So here, this is the cut or retaining wall proposed. And this is the existing profile of the bund done. And there is a failure here. I'll show you the photograph. And this is the slip circle analysis based on that. And these are the nails proposed to prevent this failure. So these are all the nails done after failure occurred actually. So you can see this is the building and these footings got exposed and they have done the restoration. This is the rig for drilling the holes and inserting the nails. So, once the excavation is already done, then it is very difficult to restore it. That's why you should always consider before commencing the excavation itself. Whether you go for shoring piles or anchors, you have to take a decision considering the soil strata and the risk levels. So, these are all the photographs of the executed work. And these are the soldiers actually. You can have valor or soldier or combination of both. So these are the soldiers. So these are all the works done. And once this slope protection is done, it can be, we can start the foundation works peacefully. So here you can see the deep depth of the foundation and here you can see restoration happened with the sandbags and then they have done this restoration of the slope protection after failure. So always better commence this protection before commencing the excavation itself. So this is the method of protecting the existing retaining wall with the anchors and the piles. You can also use the steel piles embedded in concrete. So this is the, you can see this is how it fails. Imagine the fate of this building, existing building, when you have done the excavation, footings get exposed and the drains get damaged. It will be huge cost in restoration actually. So it is better if you take precaution before commencing the excavation itself. So here you can see touch piles. So this is the restoration. We were given advices where touch piles have failed in clay soils also. So we had to give advice. So here this is after restoration. After the collapse, this is restored and now it is ready for foundations. And the slabs are laid. These are all the sites where they have failed actually. And after failing, they approach the geotechnical expert. We have seen many places in Mangalagiri, near Vijayawada and Hyderabad. Many accidents happened because of lack of proper slope protection scheme. So this is very important. I am spending more time on this because many failures are happening off late. And most, you know, IT buildings, as per the norm, they have to provide 66% parking. And mostly people go for parking below ground. But thanks to NBC revised provision now, you can have the parking floors above ground without increasing the setback. That is a relief many builders and developers have got. So clay soils also, please don't go blindly with such rules actually. So it is better you follow the advice of the geotechnical expert. And that's very important. And here also you can see the failure, after failure they are restoring the slope. We have seen the failures in all types of soils, weathered rock, clay soils and normal soils, everywhere. Whenever you go without proper technical basis and a reliability approach, these kind of accidents do happen. So we have to be very careful in taking the decision. This is that rock stitching, again I am sharing. So now I have time for questions. Anybody having questions, you can ask. Sandy soils, which is the best method of slope protection? For sandy soils, yes, sheet pile or shoring piles is a better method. If you have uniform sandy soil strata up to the depth of excavation. Good morning, Dr. Aswath. Thank you, I am seeing you. You are joining this lecture. Dr. Aswath is a principal of BITS, I think, Bangalore. Can timber logging be used for this? Yeah, for temporary works, yes, timber can be used for piles. How to increase the bearing capacity of sandy soils, having bearing capacity of 15 ton per square meter? Method only we'll discuss, please don't adopt this, but you can go for these stone columns in the sandy soils. You can stabilize the sandy soils with this. Thank you, Subhashji. What is the minimum size can be used for anchor wire? 12 mm? 12 mm is minimum normally adopted. Explain overview on touch piles. Touch piles is nothing but piles at close spacing. That means if you use 900 mm dia piles, you can have center to center of 1 meter. That is called touch pile. And we do alternate piles first and then do intermediate gaps. Active and passive. Passive anchor is like a nail. Just drill a hole, put the rod and leave it. That is passive. Active means you stress it and then I don't prefer, sorry, I have not given that blanket statement. We have to be very careful for deciding the active anchors or passive anchors very carefully. Overview of touch piles, yes, we drill the piles. Pile socketing has to be done beyond the depth of excavation. What is the maximum size? Yeah, that I have explained. Overview of untouched pile and difference between active and passive anchors. Active anchors are stressed actually. Passive means just nails. That is called passive. Quickest method to calculate the density of compacted soil. We have to ask the soil expert. Soil nailing for all types? No, not necessarily. We have done touch piles also, we have done diaphragm walls, we have done top-down construction. Have you experienced any failure after treatment? After active anchors, we didn't encounter failure actually. How is the cost comparison of shoring active anchor? In fact, active anchor is a cheaper solution compared to shoring. Shoring, you must go when active anchors cannot be adopted. Active anchor is the most economical method. Passive anchors are nails or rock nails or rock bolts are used in tunnels actually. That is as we do the tunneling. Diaphragm walls and touch piles. This is what I always say, we have to do the value engineering before deciding any method. We have to take costing for different methods and take decision. I'll come. Hi. Sharing your experience. How much depth of soil is to be stabilized for flooring in filled up lake areas? Depends on the loading on the floor actually. Suppose the influence of the load we have to consider and then decide the depth of stabilization. Normally 4 meters, 6 meters is the depth of stabilization we have to do for flooring if you have 1 ton to 5 tons floor load. Beyond that we have to go for design depending, considering the soil type. Piling, won't it disturb the adjacent building? No, we have done it already. We have to maintain minimum distance from the existing footings. 2 meters, 3 meters distance we have to maintain. If you are applying tension to the anchor, means inducing compression to soil. Yeah, it is like pre-stressing. We are pre-stressing the soil. By putting the anchor on the soil, we are inducing the compression. You stress an anchor to the soil. Can we take in where there is a proposed footing above existing well? Yeah, this is what I have done with stone columns. We have driven the stone, kadi stones into the well and we have stabilized. With the 3 meter depth of kadi, we could achieve 20 ton per square meter bearing capacity. What are the geotechnical investigations done before deep excavation? Yeah, it is standard borehole investigation and we have to have these shear parameters, C5 values, and if it is a rock, crushing strength and all that, and also RQD. In case of rock, please conduct the RQD. Sorry, I am a structural consultant, but as a structural consultant, we have to decide on all this, so I have to learn from geotechnical expert, and that's why I thanked the geotechnical expert engineer Ram Babu before even talking, and my batchmate Professor Vishnath in IIT Bombay. I take their advices, and Dr. C.V. Prasad, Professor Srinivas Murthy garu retired from Bangalore IISc. All these people help us in designing, but I have to tell engineers to take their advice, geotechnical experts' advice. Sandbag bunding not a cost effective? Yes, it is only emergency solution. Restoration we use sandbags, but not a generic solution. Yeah, only when failure happens, because we have to do the retaining wall construction after excavating. The retaining wall is vertical, you can't have vertical sandbag thing. In rapid urban and industrial growth demand land in such case reclaimed soil. We encountered in such reclaimed soil land. What is this? Sorry, I am not able to read. Oh. How much increase bearing pressure expect by adopting such improvement? It's not how much actually. Minimum we should target to achieve 20 ton per square meter for any foundation, any type of foundation. What is the difference between touch piles and active piles? Touch piles means a pile one next to the other. That means it will form like a wall. That is why we call it touch pile. And the normal piles are friction piles or end bearing piles. Here they are moment resisting, retaining wall kind of thing. But these touch piles will anchor by putting the anchor and valer actually to support the touch pile to resist the moment. For constructing roads and clay soil, soil stabilization method. Yeah, actually Amol Shingareji has done this soil stabilization for on clay strata for making roads for Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana and other project. And he was he's received awards also for innovative method. So Amol Shingare is a geotechnical expert from Nagpur. Sometimes compaction is not possible for mass filling used in unavoidable circumstances. In that case, yeah, we have to use these methods, compaction, grouting and all that kind of methods. Stepped excavation for clay soil. Yeah, if it is stiff clay and if there is no water ingress, then it can be done in clay soils, stepped excavation. Up to at least 1.5 times beyond depth of excavation. Yes, that is for the foundation design. Sand piling. Sand piling is for porous vertical drains we can do so that the water can come out through this porous sand. Thank you, Anand Daveji. Do raft foundation help improving soil shear? No, raft won't help actually. Raft acts by confining the soil actually. Sandy, silty soils only. All this kind of soil stabilization is required. Not necessarily, wherever we have lesser or poor soils. Even sandy soils, we had poor soils sometime where we had to do this. Minimum distance between two layers of horizontal valors. It is by the capacity of the anchors actually, normally it goes up to 1.5 meter, 2 meter distance. Cement slurry grouting under the prepared foundation level is safer or not, considering the, we have to consider the soil properties, and then after this cement injection, we should see, we can test the soil samples with this cement injection and decide how much cement to be used for that. Cement lumps in soil below. Formation cement, no, once we make the slurry and do pressure grouting, pressure injection, then lumps formation will not happen. It's not pure cement, it is slurry always. How much CBR value? Minimum 7 CBR we have to consider. And in waterlogged areas, can we use soil nailing after dewatering? No, it's not really a good solution. But we have to take the geotech advice for, depending on the need and application. All types of soil protection for economic point of view. Best method for all types. No, there is no, that's why I always say there is no generic solution. We have to study the soil properties, and there are so many methods I have explained today. So we have to decide which method is best suited for given soil condition and given application. When should filled up soil be taken up for construction? Yeah, we have seen in Dubai, this palm island, where they have done filled up soil by rainbowing and then did the construction on top of that. Whenever you do reclaiming, reclaimed soils, we have, they are all filled up soils. So there we have to do this soil stabilization. Extract the soil to specify depth. Yes, stone column only for below footing or complete. Yeah, we have to decide, suppose we have an open well, Then stone columns we introduce for the entire well area and then put the footing on top, because confinement is required for stabilization. Shall we go for bentonite powder? Yeah, bentonite also can be used, yes, instead of lime. Bentonite is a pulverized clay, is not good for... No, any material that can be used to stabilize depending on the chemical properties. We design the building or any structure with pile foundation up to required depth. Will not act as a ground improvement. Yeah, will not call. Pile foundation is a deep foundation. For loose soils, how can we make slope soil stabilization? Yeah, we can do by using the grouting methods and all. You do the ground improvement and then start cutting. That is also possible. Thank you very much. Boulders packing with sand will help ground improvement in silty clay. Yeah, that's right. It can be done. What would be the length of stone columns for ground improvement for 250 square yards villa? It is 10 feet, 3 meters. SPT value 5 to 6 is very less. Thank you. We have an old building and now proposed a high-rise wing touching the building. What type of pile should be preferred for stabilizing existing building? We have to confine by putting a cutoff pile and then do whatever loading you want so that the existing building won't be disturbed. Amount of lime, 3% lime we use actually. There are SSR standard schedule mentioning this. Thank you, sir. KGK Garu, how to increase black cotton marine soil? Bearing capacity of marine soil. Yeah, PVDs is one good method. We use the PVDs, then do the filling. BC soil, what will be the thickness of concrete floor? We have done even with 150 thick concrete floor for 1-ton, 2-ton floor load actually on a BC soil, but we have created layer of filling on the black cotton soil for proper subgrade. Applicability of helical piles. Helical pile means helical ties actually. Is a site soil being liquefied up to 5.5 meter? Which soil stabilization method? You can go for injection grouting and create these piles. Pile, yes, you can do. Any scaffolding can be used to protect soil. Scaffolding? No. So that will be difficult because you need more space. You have to excavate more for constructing the retaining wall. How much layer thickness in backfilling adopted in open cast foundation? Backfilling thickness, layer. Yeah, that is normal as per standard is 230 mm or 300 mm. Ground improvement by GSB. Yeah, it can be done. GSB is also one of the materials we use. SBC improved by stone column remains same in flooding season. Yeah, that we have to consider saturation condition. Helical pile is some sort of augers. Screw pile, sorry. Yeah, my friend has done a research on this. Dr. Prasad is in US. He has done the screw piles. They are called screw piles, helical piles. Yes. When geotextile geogrid be used? In embankments basically and backfills or approaches, we use this geogrid. So thank you very much. Had a good time. Thank you all. Have a good day again at homes with family. And we'll meet tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Bye.